Welcome to Redeeming the Time with Carol Marie. Redeeming the Time is a series of purpose-filled insights for you to redeem God's time with fresh revelation from the Lord. Stay tuned for today's message.
All right, welcome to Prophetic Prayer Power. And you are enjoying our time. We call it Redeeming the Time because we're redeeming the time. Woo-hoo. Isn't that great?
Yes.
And I love it that the Lord is the great Redeemer. You know, He redeems with interest.
Yes.
I love that about Him.
Yes.
He doesn't just buy back, you know, what we lost, but He redeems it with interest. Mm-hmm. And He doesn't just make lemonade out of our lemons, but I tell you, I think it's lemon meringue pie, cheesecake all run together. He knows how to make it special. And we can trust Him. Say, I can trust Him.
I can trust Him.
Yeah. He's worthy to be trusted.
Yes.
And you know, have you ever had a child or an individual that you gave your word on something and they just didn't believe you? And they went, I mean, it hurts you.
Mm-hmm.
How do you think it is with God?
Mm.
You know, when He gives us a word and then we, and we worry anyway, or we be frustrated or complain, you know? And we're supposed to be trusting Him. You know, we can trust Him. I'm already tearing up.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be talking about today, one of my very favorite subjects, is the weapon of love. You know, sometimes we just think of love being a gushy, fun feeling, but it's a weapon, you guys. And it's a weapon that never fails.
That's right.
Love never fails.
Amen.
Say, love never fails.
Love never fails.
Because it always works.
Because it always works.
It always works.
It always works.
Because it never fails.
It never fails.
Never ever.
Never ever.
You know, if we get that into our spirit, if you don't know what to do, you love.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not sure what to do, love. And we're going to look at this. It's really not an option. It isn't whether you feel like it or not, or if that person deserves it or not. It's a commandment, okay? So let's look on your sheet. And those of you that are viewing this on the internet or on our website, you can download the notes that we're looking at and follow right along and do it at home. If you're wanting to be an intercessor, this is part of being positioned to intercede for businesses and cupbearers and gatekeepers for Anna's Gate is studying the Prophetic Prayer Power lessons. So first of all, let's look at John 13, 34 and 35. This is from the Amplified. I am convinced that Jesus spoke in Amplified. Paul, I'm sure, did. Yeah, just spoke in Amplified, you know. Yeah, just kept going. Okay, so this is what Jesus says. I give you a new commandment. Say new.
New.
It's a new commandment that you should love one another just as I have loved you. So, you should love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. If you keep on showing love among yourselves. Now when he's speaking this, he's sharing this to the disciples, and Judas is a part of that group. And Jesus knows that he's going to be betrayed by Judas. In fact, Jesus knows that he's been stealing from the treasury. And yet Jesus still picked him to be a disciple. And he loved him in such a way that when they were having the Seder dinner, what we call the Last Supper, and everybody's around there, and he says, there's one of you that's going to betray me. He never gave any hints towards Judas. You know, if it was one of us, we would, I know who it is, you know, because we've given some little hints or their body language or whatever, rolled our eyes or something. But Jesus didn't. They all said, is it me, Lord? Is it me? What I did, you know? They're all, in fact, when, and he said the one that dips his bread in the sup, is going to betray me. And Judas did that, and then Jesus said, go do what you're supposed to do, or, you know, do. Go ahead. Well, they all thought he was going to go buy food for the poor. Jesus loved Judas. And he didn't pick up offense. He didn't put blame. He didn't carry unforgiveness. He saw things from the Father's point of view, didn't he? So he's commanded us, given us a new commandment, that we love one another the same way Jesus loves. That's how we love, right?
Right.
John 15:12-14. This is my commandment, that you love one another, just as I've loved you. Now, we just read that in chapter 13, didn't we? And all throughout that. I mean, it'd be good. I don't know if any of you have ever studied that, of how many times Jesus said, this is a new commandment, or said the word love. That'd be a fun thing to check out. In those last, from 14 to 17, when he's given his last words of that are important to him, you know, and see how many times he's mentioned that. So John 15, he picks it up, and he says, this is my commandment, that you love one another just as I've loved you. In case you didn't catch on in chapter 13, let's reiterate here. No one has greater love, no one has shown stronger affection than to lay down or give up his own life for his friends. You are my friends if you keep on doing the things which I command you to do. Okay, so we're getting a clue here. He's given us a new commandment. We're to love as he loves, right? And the way to love is a way where you are willing to lay down your life for your friends. And then he says, you're my friends. Now, if we're to love as he loves, that means we're to lay our life down. Now, that doesn't mean we have to go lay down on a railroad track or something, you know. We're talking about our will, laying our will down, deferring to one another, where we're fighting over who can bless the other person instead of hurrying, getting in line before anybody else gets in line. You know, just look for ways to be kind.
Right, right.
You know, kindness is a part of love. What does love look like? Let's look here. The whole chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians. If I speak with tongues of men and even of angels, but do not love, that reasoning, intentional, spiritual devotion that's inspired by God's love for us and in us, I'm only a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. So we could do wonderful things. We could prophesy amazing words. But if it's not inspired by love, it's just noisy, mm-hmm. as far as God's concerned.
Yeah.
If I have prophetic powers, the gift of interpreting the divine will and purposes, and understand all secret truths and mysteries. Can you imagine? Understand all secret truths and mysteries. Whoa. Look at that. And possess all knowledge. And if I have sufficient faith that I can remove mountains, but have not love, God's love in me, I am nothing. A useless nobody.
That's right.
Even if I dole out all that I have to the poor in providing food, and if I surrender my body to be burned, or in order that I may glory, but have not love, God's love in me, I gain nothing. You know, being a martyr. But, if, you know, being willing to die for a cause, you know, you gain nothing. And then the next section talks about what love is. And we've heard this, but I want you to know that this word love, in the Greek here, it means charity. It means love in action. It does not mean a funny feeling or a sweet feeling that you have for one another. It is an act of charity. That's why King James translated it charity. It's an act of benevolence. It's an act of kindness. Love is an action. Say, love is an action.
Love is an action.
And I choose to let love flow through me.
And I choose to let love flow through me.
Because God is love.
Because God is love.
And God dwells within me.
And because God dwells within me.
And so love dwells within me.
So love dwells within me.
So when I'm commanded to love.
So when I'm commanded to love.
I'm able to love.
I'm able to love.
Because love dwells in me.
Because love dwells in me.
I just choose to let it flow.
I just choose to let it flow.
Let's give Him praise.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. So what does love look like? Let's look at this. Again, this is from the Amplified, taking it from 1 Corinthians 13. It says, and I just warn you, it's going to step on somebody's toes, because it steps on mine too. Love endures long. It's patient and kind. Love never is envious nor boils over with jealousy. It is not boastful or vainglorious, does not display itself haughtily. Because it's not about us, is it? See, if we can lose ourselves, if we can lay our life on the altar and let it just be Him, how can you be glorified today, Lord? How can you love through me? Look for opportunities to love. I was at Kroger's, and I was jumping in my car, and there was a bigger car, like a van, and then there was this little zippy sports car. It was an SUV, and then there was a zippy sports car, and this lady kept trying to back out. Well, they couldn't see her because of the other car, so every time she'd start to scoot out, another car would scoot out, and so then she would scoot back in, and then she'd start to scoot out. So I saw what was going on, so I just stood in the road and directed traffic. And I just said, okay, honey, it's your turn, you know, and you guys can wait, you know. Do you know, just acts of kindness.
That's right. That's right.
And she just thanked me because, you know what happened? I could see her getting frustrated. And when you see impatience or, you know, offense, have you noticed how quickly offense can happen? I mean, it's sneaky. All of a sudden you're offended and you're going, what? And it was over nothing. So I could see her actions that she could have been offended, you know, like, hello, you know, it's my turn, you know. And just doing something, it shifted the situation. Many of you know the story I shared about my love buy at Starbucks, and so we were in the car getting ready to get a Starbucks, and there was this long line. You never want to go during when everybody's going to work in the morning. That's lined way up. But anyway, we pulled in there, and because of there was a car that was had been waiting. And so they let that car come in that had kind of came in from the side. And so then there are other cars like this. Well, this young Jehu, you know, these warriors, 20-year-old, you know, this gal pulls up, and she's determined she's going to scoot in there. And so the lady in front of us let her know, no. And the lady, yeah, I was here. And she said, no, you can. She was letting her. And it wasn't just about her. There was other people behind her, you know. Well, as soon as there was an opening, that gal gunned it and scooted right in front. Well, the lady in front of us got so upset. All the way around the building, she kept beeping at her. She was letting her know she was not happy with that. And she got, Kathy Skiles was in there, and I go, Kathy, we've got to shift this situation. So when we order, tell her that we're going to pay for the gal in front of us. So anyway, we told her that. Well, we get up there, and we're right behind the gal in front of us, and I watch her pull money out and pay. I jump out of the car, run up there, and I go, no, we're paying for yours. She said, no, you're not. You saw my road rage, and so I'm paying for yours. But you know what? You can shift stuff. You don't have to think, well, you know, shake it off, get over it. You know, a lot of times we want to just say, grow up. You know, but sometimes it needs an act of kindness to shift the situation. So we got our coffee free that morning just by being kind. Okay, so you endure long. So what? I mean, I fly a lot. You'd be amazed how many people want to get on that airplane so fast so they can sit and wait in a cramped area. You know, what's with that? And then they want to hurry and get out, and they're pulling suitcases down, and there's no room for anybody. You know? Love endures long. It's patient. It's patient. What about getting this one guy? He was across the aisle from me in the airplane, and he helped the lady get her suitcase up, and then he helped me. I thought, honey, bless you. Oh, you're so kind. You know, just affirming. It's okay to be kind, you guys.
Yes.
All right, number 5, verse 5. It is not conceited, arrogant, inflated with pride. Notice we started out, it's not prideful, vainglorious, or boastful. So pride will rob you of love. See, if you think you deserve it, let me show you how that pride is. This entitlement stuff, guys, we don't, nobody owes us anything.
That's right.
It's an honor that God gives us breath.
Amen.
Nobody owes us. You know, this attitude, well, you need to do this for me, you need to do this for me. Nah. Uh-uh. We need to just be thankful. We've got to have a grateful heart. A grateful heart opens a door to be thankful. Right? You enter the courts with thanksgiving.
Yeah.
And then thankfulness opens it up for praise. Praise opens us up for worship. Worship opens us up to His glory. Everything we need is in His glory.
Amen.
But if you don't start with a grateful heart, you're not going to get in the glory. And gratefulness will help counteract pride. It's not arrogant, inflated with pride. It's not rude or unmannerly. Oh. My goodness. We were in a restaurant, and the waiter, the guy that was got his bill, he's checking every little thing, and there was a dollar that was off. And so he let that waiter know that he had miscalculated, and he overcharged him a dollar. So the young man says, well, I'll give you a dollar. And the man says, well, I'll just take it out of your tip. Boy, and then when the waiter left, the man turns to his wife like he's real proud of himself. I showed him. I just thought, yeah. I thought, so when I saw the guy, I tipped him double. I fixed him. Okay, it's not rude, unmannerly, or unbecomingly. Goodness, if Jesus was with us, how would we act, really? You know, really. Love, God's love in us, does not insist on its own rights or its own way. It's not self-seeking. It's not touchy or fretful or resentful. Say, I'm not touchy.
I'm not touchy.
See, if you got poked, what comes out?
The giggle.
Oh. Huh? when you get poked, then, you know, is it Jesus that comes out?
Right.
Is it the fruit of the Spirit
right.
that comes out?
That's right. Amen.
Okay, it takes no account of evil done to it. It takes no account. Well, this is the last straw. You've done this before. I remember in 1943 you did it. I remember the time when, and I'm going, what?
Yeah.
That was 20 years ago. I don't remember it, but I'm sorry if I did that, you know? Not touchy, not resentful, not fretful. The word fret means to eat yourself up. And there really was a cannibal tribe called the Fret Tribe that ate themselves up. Honestly, they're not around anymore. That's true. It's true. Yeah, you eat yourself up with worry. Yeah. Doesn't even sound tasty to me. It does not, it takes no account of the evil done to it. It pays no attention to a suffered wrong. It pays no attention. Like, just let it roll off. Pays no attention of suffered wrong. That means there's been some suffering. Injustice, well, that's not fair. Pays no attention to it. I want people to give me the benefit of the doubt.
Right. Amen.
Say, I will give you,
I will give you
the benefit of the doubt.
The benefit of the doubt.
Because I'm not touching.
Because I'm not touching.
Amen. Let's praise Him. So we are looking at what love looks like. We're looking at love in the right places.
Amen.
That dates me on some of the country western people that may know that song. Looking for love in all the wrong places, but we're looking in the right places.
Amen.
Let's look at verse 6. We're talking about love. It does not rejoice at injustice and unrighteousness, but rejoices when right and truth prevail.
Yes.
Now let me give you an example of that. All right, something happens. Maybe there's somebody that has been just taken advantage of other people and whatever, and all of a sudden you hear that they were taken advantage of. Now then, almost the normal reaction is, well, good. Serves you right. But it's still wrong. If somebody took advantage of them, it's still wrong. It doesn't determine, well, it's okay for you to be taken advantage of because you've done it to other people. No, you let God deal with them on that. We don't rejoice when evil prevails. No. We rejoice when love prevails. Okay? All right? And when truth prevails. All right, when you're seeing something happen, see what happens is many times when we're seeing somebody be taken advantage of, or we see a situation that isn't right, then our righteous indignation rises up. You know, we're going to, and we put judgment on that situation. Now, that doesn't mean that we're not wise and that we're not discerning what's going on, but what do you do with the information? You begin to pray into it. Okay, if injustice has taken place, then we begin to intercede and seek God, and we release justice, don't we? We start releasing what the situation is, and maybe He gives you an act or guidance of what to do to shift something. You know, in Job 29, it said that He snatched the prey out of the mouth of the wicked and broke the jaws of the wicked so that the wicked couldn't do that anymore. So it doesn't mean that we just let it happen. See, but we don't rejoice in injustice. You hear me? What we do is we seek God and we say, okay, how do I handle this? You know, maybe it's a legal thing that we need to do. Maybe we need to pray in some godly leaders. You know, what is it that's needed? But we don't rejoice in evil.
Right.
You follow me?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's so easy. I mean, look on Facebook, you guys, how much blasting takes place of our president. Mm-hmm. And yet the scripture commands us to pray for those that are in authority over us. Yeah. Sometimes I'd like to say, all right, have you prayed for our president today? You know, you've asked me to share this all over the world. Blasting him, that doesn't mean that I agree on everything that he does, but you know what? I'm commanded to pray for him.
Right.
Okay, how's your toes doing? Okay, verse 7, love bears up under anything and everything that comes. Love bears up under anything and everything that comes. Love bears up. So you can't say, oh, I can't take any more. The lie is, it's too big, it's too hard, I can't handle it anymore, this is the last straw. Love bears up under anything and everything. Love, you know, love never fails. So love is a power. It's not just a gushy feeling. It's a power, and it bears
right.
us up. It undergirds us.
That's right. Amen.
Okay? It is ever ready. Oh, it's a battery. Ever ready, Bunny Rabbit. Yeah. It's ever ready to believe the best of every person. Look at Jesus believed the best of Judas.
Yes.
And everybody else, you know, they didn't. Later they said, we found out he's stealing from the treasury and all of these things. But you know what? Jesus believed the best in him. Okay? Let's believe the best. Its hopes are fadeless. Oh, so don't let yourself say, it's a hopeless situation. Or this'll never happen. They'll never get that job. They'll never get out of prison, or they'll never, whatever the thing. No, don't
right.
take the hope out.
Right.
Everything is possible with God.
That's right.
Okay? So its hopes are fadeless under all circumstances. It's endless. It endures everything without weakening. It endures. All right. So right now, if you have agreed with a lie, this is so subtle that it just seems hopeless. Maybe about yourself or your situation or kids or grandkids or whatever. And this thought has come to you right now. Just repent of that. Lord, we repent of feeling that things are hopeless or even saying that things are hopeless. And we repent and we ask you to forgive us, Lord. Because according to your word, love's hopes are fadeless. And we all have love. Amen. And it endures everything without weakening. So it's our Popeye spinach. It gives us strength. Verse 8, love never fails. Say that with me. Love never fails. Never fades out or becomes obsolete or comes to an end. You know, it's never going to go out of fashion. You know, you don't have to. Even when I was teaching Dress for Success and all that, I'd put on fashion shows and I'd have to study what the colors were and the look, and then people would come in and I'd give them what the up-to-date stuff was so that they knew how to prepare for the next season. Oh, Lord, help us if we had the wrong color on or whatever, you know. So I was getting my group ready, you know. And love is always fashionable, you guys. You don't have, just love. You don't have to worry about it. And if you have the wrong color shoes on, just love. They won't even notice. Okay. As for prophecy, the gift of interpreting divine will and purpose, it will be fulfilled and pass away. As for tongues, they will be destroyed or ceased. Or as for knowledge, it will pass away. It will lose its value, be superseded by truth. For our knowledge is fragmentary, incomplete, and imperfect, and our prophecy is fragmentary, incomplete, and imperfect. Now, I put a little note there, 1 Corinthians 14:1. It starts right out talking about have love and to go after the gifts. So it's not saying that the gifts have ended. It's saying it's in, you know, we see in part, we prophesy in part, you know, it's not perfect. When that which is perfect has come, you know, then we don't need to do it in part. Hello? Yeah. Okay. But when the complete, verse 10, and perfect total comes, the incomplete and perfect will vanish away, being void, okay, or superseded. Now, is everything perfect yet?
No.
No. I think I need all the help I can get, don't you? Yeah. We need to move. We need to open up to all the gifts. We need to open up to the fruit of the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit. We need to have all of Holy Spirit we can have to lead us and guide us. All right, verse 11. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. Now that I became a man, I've done away with childish things and I put them aside. Okay. Let me just say to you, not acting in love is childish.
Right.
It's time to grow up.
That's right.
And we can choose to respond in love.
Yes.
We don't have to throw a tantrum, have our own way. When a little kid does that, you know, you spank them. Well, I did anyway. You know, when they're throwing a fit, you know, if you don't take care of it and guide them when they're young, then you end up with having a teenager that's having problems being guided. You know, why are we acting that way? Why do we think that we should be able to just throw little fits? And, well, you'll understand, you love me. No, we need to grow up.
Right.
We need to grow up. We're commanded to love, and it's time to love.
That's right.
Say, Lord.
Lord.
I choose to grow up.
I choose to grow up.
I am going to be a mature.
I'm going to be a mature.
Son of God.
That
you can trust me with more love.
In
Jesus' name, let's praise Him. So as we finish up looking at what does love look like, we're in 1 Corinthians 13. Let's look at verse 12. For now we're looking in a mirror that gives only a dim or blurred reflection. But then, when perfection comes, we shall see in reality face to face, right? Now I know in part, or imperfectly, but then I will know and understand fully, clearly, even in the same manner as I have been fully and clearly known and understood by God. And so, faith, hope, and love abide. Faith, conviction, and belief representing God's relationship, man's relationship with God and divine things. Hope. Joyful and confident expectation of eternal salvation, and love, true affection for God and man, growing out of God's love for and in us, these three, but the greatest of these is love. So notice at the beginning, and so faith, hope, and love abideth. Say, faith, hope, and love abides.
Faith, hope, and love abides.
Abides means that it stays with us. It abides. So, we have faith, we have hope, and we have love, right? Because it abides, right? Yeah, we've got it.
Yes.
All right. Okay, and the greatest of these are love, is love. Okay, so what does this love include? What does it, let's look at it. Now, all the things that we read over, we would have to forgive, wouldn't we? I mean, if somebody does something, if we're long-suffering, we're going to forgive if it doesn't get touchy, if it doesn't even notice if it's been done wrong to. Huh? Yeah, it's forgiven. Yeah, you're not going to pick up offense. You're going to forgive. It's also showing acts of kindness. Look for ways to be kind. Sometimes we put these things in a different category, but it's a part of love. Charity, which is benevolence, doing your love buys, paying for the person that's in road rage. Pay for theirs. You know, do what you can do. Sometimes I'll just go into Shoney's and I'll look around. I love the cabbage soup that they have. And every once in a while I get hungry for it. And I'll go in there and I just look to see if there's somebody sitting there that just looks like they're not doing well, you know? And I'll just say, I want to pay for their meal, you know. Don't tell them. Wait until after I go, you know. But let them know that it's been paid for. Do look for ways to be kind. Sow kindness, okay? All right. And then choose to grow up and not be childish like we just said, okay? Now, what does it not look like? I'm going to give you some hidden information. Are you ready for that? The rest of the story, like Paul Harvey. All right, first of all, Ezekiel 16, 49 and 50, it explains the sin of Sodom, okay? And we automatically, oh, Sodom and sodomy and all that, that's homosexuality. Well, look what the scripture says. Behold, this was the iniquity of your sister Sodom, pride. Look at that. Remember we saw that all the way through, what love is not, you know? Pride, overabundance of food, prosperous ease, idleness were hers and her daughters. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. And they were haughty, there's pride again, and committed abominable offenses before me. Therefore I removed them when I saw it and saw fit. Wow. She didn't, the city of Sodom didn't strengthen the hand of the help the poor and needy. Let me give you a little bit of history on Sodom. Okay, if you saw the whole region, it would have been more of a desolate area, and all of a sudden, here's Sodom. And it was a city that had a lot of springs, had a lot of growth, it flourished. The people were really happy with what they had. And so, if a stranger were to come into their city, their judges, everything was set up to do it, to back this up. If somebody were to come into the city, what they would do is they would take their goods or tell them that they owed them something. And many times they would beat them, many times they'd rape them. But the whole thing was they were going to get rid of the stranger. They didn't want anybody moving into their city because this is mine. I don't think I have enough for you. This is my stuff. Look at that attitude, you guys. Sometimes we think, oh, I don't have enough for me. We're calculating, and instead of trusting God, let Him move on your heart and let you and show you what to do, you know? Anyway, so they were protecting their city, and they would say that the stranger owed money. They'd go to the court, and then the judge would say, yep, you owe them money. And they'd take what was theirs. If they give them any problem, they would hurt them, you know, sometimes kill them. In fact, in the book of Jasher, it talks about that one of Lot's daughters that was married, they had a stranger. What they did was they tied him up or something so that he couldn't eat or drink. And the whole city, nobody in the city could help him. And so they were just watching him die. They robbed him, took his stuff, but nobody was supposed to help him. And Lot's daughter kept sneaking water to him and giving him something. And they kept thinking, why hasn't he died yet? And so they said, well, we'll watch. And so they hid and watched to see, and they caught her, and they ended up killing her because she helped the stranger. So let me take you this a step further. So now when we're looking at Genesis 19, when the Lord comes and he speaks to Abraham and he tells him what his intentions are, and Abraham begins to intercede on behalf of Sodom, doesn't he? And because Lot and the family is there, all right? And so the Lord sends angels into the city. Now, according to the sages, what they say is that what they were checking to see is, was Lot still kind? Would he be kind to a stranger? Had the city's mentality corrupted him? Is he worthy of being saved? Whoa. So they go into the city and they act like they're just going to stay in the city's area, the court, you know. Well, Lot sees them at the gate. He compels them to come into his house. They say, no, we're just going to stay out here in the courtyard. We'll be fine. No, he gets them in the house. He feeds them. He washes their feet. He takes care of them. Then the men of the city surround the house and they say, bring that man out. Now we says, because we want to know him. And in the Hebrew, that means intimacy. But it wasn't just that. They were going to rob him, and it wasn't. They said, who are you to be our judge? Remember? The angels were sent there to see if he would be kind. All right. Many times we look at this passage too and we go, you know what? You know, and we look at Lot's wife looking back, you know, and we go, well, she shouldn't have looked back. Here we are in our righteousness, you know. Well, she was told not to look back, and then she looked back and turned into a pillar of salt. Well, look at the passage again. In the passage, the angels give Lot permission to go to his married daughters and the son-in-laws and tell them what's going to happen and ask them to leave. And the son-in-laws mock him and say, oh, no, that's not going to happen. And they refuse to go. And so then, the next morning, the angels just whisk a lot, his wife and the two daughters that are there, get them out of the city. Okay, so the other daughters and their husbands are still in the city. So, now, how many mamas are in this room? Raise your hand. Now, if your daughter was in that city, and you know it's going to be destroyed, hey, don't put judgment on that gal. In fact, the sages says that's why she looked back. She looked back. She wasn't longing for the wickedness of the city. She's longing for her children. Whew. The angels were sent there to see if he'd be kind. And judgment came on a city because they weren't kind, you guys. We've got to. The times that we're moving in right now, people, there's so much, have you noticed so much in the atmosphere? People are getting frightened, they're frustrated, they don't have enough money, they don't know what they're going to do. We've got to be kind. We've got to love. That's crazy. All right. So we found out that love is a weapon. It's a powerful weapon, you guys. It never fails. I mean, it never misfires. I mean, it hits the bullseye every time. Yeah, it never fails. How do we activate it? Look at John 15, 7 through 12. Jesus says, if you live in me or abide virtually, let's start over again. If you live in me, abide vitally. It should be virtually, too. Let it be every aspect of our life. United to him, my words remain in you and continue to live in your hearts. Ask whatever you will and it'll be done for you. When you bear or produce much fruit, my Father is honored and glorified, and you show and prove yourselves to be true followers of mine. I have loved you just as the Father has loved me. Whoa. Abide in my love. Continue in his love with me. If you keep my commandments, if you continue to obey my instructions, you will abide in my love and live on in it. Just as I have obeyed my Father's commandments and live on his love, I have told you these things that my joy and delight might be in you, and that your joy and gladness may be full. Be of full measure, complete and overflowing. This is my commandment, that you love one another just as I've loved you. Now look at the promises that are there. First of all, the more we understand his love for us, the more we can produce the fruit of love for others. So that means we need to get into the Word, don't we? We need to look up scriptures on the Father's love for us. The same love that Jesus experienced that the Father's love in Jesus said is in us. So we need to understand the Father's love. The Spirit, make it in your little notes, put understanding the Spirit of adoption. You know, that doesn't mean that you were just adopted from another family. It means that he chose us, loved us before the foundation of the earth, and he loved us. And if we can get a hold of the love of the Father for us, when we don't deserve it, you guys,
right.
We don't deserve it, then we'll be able to love the unlovely, you guys.
Yes.
All right? Obey the law of love, and it will cause us to grow in love. He said to live in love. So how do we live in love? By obeying his word, obeying his commandments. And his commandment was to love.
Mm-hmm.
To love as he loves. Whoa, that's a standard, isn't it? Okay? We're told to bear fruit. In Galatians 5, 22 and 23, you know, it says the fruit of the Spirit is love. And then it tells you what's a part of love, which includes kindness and forgiveness and charity and all that, you know, and gentleness and goodness, forbearance, self-control. See that? See, if you take that, take this, this is your homework, take this verse in Galatians and compare it to what we just studied in 1 Corinthians 13. It'll line up, you guys.
Mm-hmm.
The fruit of the Spirit of love will line up with what love is. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the benefits of it Jesus said, ask what you will and it'll be done. My goodness. So we walk in love. And it gives us power to ask what we will and it will be done. I mean, my goodness, it's like a blank check. Okay, look at the second one. Joy is complete and overflowing in our lives. Who wants happiness? Who wants joy? Yeah. When we move in love, it brings such joy, overflowing joy. I mean, it makes me giggle. Well, we laughed for hours after that Starbucks situation. You know? No, I'm paying for yours because you saw my road rage. You know, we shifted that situation. Her whole day would have been a bad day. But we shifted it with love. Okay? So say, Father, thank you.
Father, thank you.
For your love.
For your love.
I choose love.
I choose love.
I choose to bear the fruit of love.
I choose to bear the fruit of love.
I choose to let you love through me.
I choose to let you love through me.
And I repent of selfishness.
And I repent of
childishness. That's it.
I repent of childishness.
I want to grow up in you.
I want to grow up in you.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Yeah. Praise Him. Yeah.
Thank you for watching Redeeming the Time with Carol Marie. We'd like to encourage you to visit annasgate.org for more information. We pray that this message has been a blessing to you.
There is an awakening taking place, and it's exploding around the body of Christ.